Welcome to the lecture number 22 of compiler design. In this lecture, we will go through the scope rules, then we will go through how to represent the scope information in the symbol table. So let me first go through what are the scope rules. So before going to the scope rules, let me tell you what is scope. Okay, so every name possesses a region of validity within the source program, that is called its scope of that name. So for example, let me give you one example. So this is the dev C++ editor. Here I will give you a small example relating to the scope. Okay, so let me declare a block over here. Let me write integer I equal to 10. So now within this block, I can assess the value of i++. I can print the value of i, printf, percentage, d, comma, i. So there is absolutely no problem, because you see this i is declared within this block, and within this block, I can assess the value of i. So this is the region where the value of i is visible. So now you see for the name I is visible. So if I will compile and execute it, let me compile and run it. So you see it will display the value of I, that is I initially is 10, then I++ means I's value will be incremented to 11. So now if I am printing the value of I, it should display 11. Okay? So it is taking a bit of time. So please have some patience. So you see here it will display 11. Now if outside this block I want to access the value of I, so let me first print it. But it's still taking some time, so please wait for a while. So now you see it has displayed 11, right? So now what I will do now, let me try to assess the value of I outside this block. So you see the value of I or the name I is visible only within this block. So this is called as scope of I. Now let me try to access the value of I outside the block, I minus minus. Now you see it will generate an error. So you see it will generate an error over here, right? Because I scope is terminated or lies within this block. So as I am trying to access the value of I or access the name I outside the block, it generates an error. So I hope all of you have understood what is the scope of a name. So the scope of a name is the region of accessibility of that name. So now the rules governing scope of names in a block structured language are as follows. What are the rules? A name declared within a block B is valid only within block B. So here you see, here let us say that this is the block B. Okay, so a name, you go through the rule, a name declared within a block B is valid only within block B. So here you see, here I have declared a name I. So this I will only valid within the block. Okay, so if this is block B, if the name of the block I will give is B, then you will see that the name I is only visible within the block B. Okay, so this rule is pretty simple. Now let me go through the second rule. So what is the second rule? If block B1 is nested within B2, it means what? Here let us say block B2, B2 is there. And within B2, there is another block B1, let us say. Okay. So here you see, if block B1 is nested within B2, means if B1 is a inner block of B2 block, then any name that is valid for B2 is also valid for B1. Means what? Here if I will declare a variable integer I equal to 5. It means what? This variable I is also valid within the inner block B1. So here if I will write printf percentage d comma I, there is absolutely no problem because the B1 is the inner block of B2. So any name that is declared within B2 is also valid within B1. So let me give you one example so that you can clearly understand this one. Okay. So let us consider that this is block B2. Okay. So within this, I have declared a variable I. Next, let me write another block. Let's say this is the block B1. This is the block B1. Right. So now you see, within the block B1, if I will access the value of I, there is absolutely no problem because B1 is the inner block of B2. It means all the names that are declared or that are in B2 is also valid for B1. So here if I will write printf percentage d comma I, so there is absolutely no problem. You see, it will display the value of I. So let me run it. So it will take some time. Let us wait for it. Now it is executing. So you see, there is absolutely no problem. It has displayed the value of I within block B1. But now let us see the reverse. So if I will declare a variable in B1 inside the inner block, let's say here I will declare integer j equal to 20. So this is visible only to block B1. Okay. So here if I will write the value of j, so it will display 20. So let me execute it, compile and run. So you see, it will display 20. There is absolutely no problem, right? But now, if I have declared a variable within the inner block B1, that will not be visible to the outer block B2. So here you see, here if I will write j++, it means what? J is declared within block B1, which is an inner block to B2. So if a variable is declared within the inner block, that cannot be accessible to the outer block. So here you see, if I will compile it, it will generate an error over here. You see, it generates an error. Okay, over here. Let me again run it. You see, there is an error over here because J is declared within the block B1, which is an inner block to B2. So all the variables declared within B2 are visible to B1, but the variables declared within B1 will not be visible to B2. Okay, so I hope all of you have understood this one. So let me go through the second rule again. So if block B1 is nested within B2, then any name that is valid for B2 is also valid for B1, right? Unless the identifier for that name is redeclared in B1. It means what? You see, let me explain you this one in this example only. So here you see, this is the block B2, right? So within this block B2, I have declared a variable I equal to 10. So that value I can access within the block B1. So here if I will write I, there is absolutely no problem because the names that are valid for B2 is also valid for B1. Because why? Because B1 is a nested block to B2. So now let me compile and execute it. It will display the value of I. There is absolutely no problem. You see, it will display 10. Now, if I will redeclare the same variable within the inner block, let me write integer I equal to 20. Now you see, so you see in B2 there is a variable I equal to 10. In B1, I have declared another variable I equal to 20. So now you see, as I have redeclared the variable I within B1, if now I will compile and execute this one, you will see it will display the value of I as 20. You see, the value of I as 20, because this I is a local variable to block B1, whereas this I is a global variable to the block B1. Okay, so when there is a local variable and a global variable, the local variable gets the preference over the global variable. So I hope all of you have understood this one. Okay. So now let me go through the scope rule again. So here you see, if block B1 is nested within B2. Okay. So now you see here block B1 is nested within B2. Okay. So first condition is true. Next, then any name that is valid for B2. So here you see, what is the name that is valid for B2? I equal to 20 is the name which is valid for, I equal to 10 is the name which is valid for B2. So this is again valid for the inner block B1. But you see, unless the identifier for that name is redeclared in B1. So you see, when we have redeclared the variable I within the inner block B1, you see the outer block I is not visible. Okay. So if the two names do not have the same name, then the outer block variable will be visible to inner block variable. But if in the outer block you have a variable or a name, and in the inner block you have redeclared the same name, so in the inner block you will access the inner variable name. Okay. So I hope all of you have understood the scope rules. Next, let me go through how we can represent this information in a symbol table. Okay. So let me write a small C program, then I will tell you how can you represent the scope information in the symbol table. So one method is to keep multiple symbol tables, one for each active block. So let me write a simple program, integer n. So here what I will write, if n equal to 0, then what is the factorial value? Factorial is 1. So I will write return 1. Else what I will write? Else I will return n into fact of n minus 1, right? So let me write a main function, integer main, and here let me declare a variable, integer k equal to 5, and here let me print the or call the factorial function printf. Factorial equal to percentage d. Here let me call the factorial function fact a. Right. Next, return 0. Now you see, here there are two blocks. One is factorial block, another one is main function block. Okay, so the variable k is only visible to main function because it is a local variable to main function. Similarly, the variable n is only visible to factorial function because the n is a local variable of factorial function. So you cannot access n in main function and you cannot access k in factorial function. So how this information will be stored in a symbol table? So what we will do, we will first create a name and attribute pair. Okay. So here, what is that? What name you have used? Here you see, here you have used a name fact. Okay. So fact is a function or it is a procedure. So let me write it as procedure. Okay. Next, n. N is a what? N is a variable. So n is a variable means it is a local variable. So it is of which type? You see, this is of integer type. So here I will write int. Right? So now what you will do, this procedure can be called from the main function. Okay. So this procedure can be called from main function. So here I will write main. Main is a what? It is again a function. Function means it is nothing but a procedure. Now here you see that in the main function I have declared a variable k. So in the main function I have declared a variable k. So what I will do here, I will write k. It is of which type? It is of integer type. So now what I will do, every time a block is encountered, I will push them into a stack. So this is the main function. This is the which function? This is the factorial function. Okay. So here it will point to null, because this is the every program execution, every C program execution starts from the main function. Okay. So from main function you have called the factorial function. Now you see, whenever you have encountered k, so you will sort it in the symbol table. So this is a symbol table, this is a symbol table, and you will sort it from the top of the stack. So first you have to sort the factorial symbol table. Then if k is not found in the top of the stack, you will sort the main function. Okay. So similarly, what you can do, you can sort the symbol table from the, or you can sort the list of symbol tables from the top of the stack. So in an active block, so you see here what you will do, one for each active block. So when you are active in a factorial function, then which symbol table you will access? You will access this symbol table. Okay. Now when this function is over, this will be popped out of the stack. So which one will be there? This one will be there. So now you will sort all the names over here, and you can get all the information of the names from here. So this is how, by maintaining multiple symbol tables in a stack, you can keep the scope information of variables. So here you see, suppose you have encountered n. So which block you will, or which symbol table you will sort? You will sort the symbol table at the top of the stack. Means the factorial symbol table for factorial function you will search. Here you see, what is n? N is a variable. What is its type? Its type is int type. So this is how you will get the information relating to the names and its scope within a program. Okay. So this is one approach for representing scope information in symbol table. So there is another approach that is called as nesting depth approach. Okay. So in nesting depth approach, what you will do, let me go through the previous example again. So here you see, here there is a variable, or there is a name n. Okay, so here what I will write, here I will write name is n, depth is 2. Why depth is 2? Because you see, first you, which function will be called? First main function will be called. So if you will first call the main function, what is the depth of main function? Depth of main function is 1, and all the variables that you have declared within main function, it is in depth 1. Next, from main function you have called the factorial function. It means the factorial function is in depth 2. So all the variables or all the names that is declared within factorial function, its depth will be 2. Okay. Similarly, here you see. So what is its type? Integer. It is an integer type. Now, what is the name? Main is the name, because main is the function name. What is its depth? Depth is, sorry, I am going for n. Okay, so first let me write the factorial. Okay, so instead of main, let me write the factorial. Factorial. What is the depth? So factorial's depth is 2. What is its type? This is a function. So I, let me write it as procedure. Right. Next, what else name I have? I have the name main function. So main is a name, and k is a name. So let me write k. What is the depth? Depth is 1, because it is inside the function main. Okay, so main function is the starting function. I have kept it depth as 1. So what is its type? K is of integer type. Next, main is the name. Okay, so its depth is 1. What is its type? Main is a function. So let me write it as procedure. So now, by maintaining this also, you will know the scope relating to a name. Okay, so here you see, here if I will write n, so what you will see, you can see that c's depth is 2. It means n's depth is 2. It means what? N is a variable of integer type which is in a function fact and whose depth is 2. So like this, you can maintain the scope information of all the names within a symbol table. So I hope all of you have understood it.